Hello, I'm Faisal Pervez, a South Asia analyst here at Stratfor, and this podcast is brought to you by Stratfor Worldview, our premier digital publication for objective geopolitical intelligence and analysis. Individual, team, and enterprise memberships are available at worldview.stratfor.com/subscribe.
Hi, I'm Fred Burton, the Chief Security Officer at Stratfor.
And I'm Scott Stewart, Stratfor's Vice President of Tactical Analysis.
Scott, I know we've written a lot about cyber criminals targeting supply chains.
One of the trends that we've been watching for our threat lens clients has been this increase in really cyber actors trying to use the software supply chain as a way to get entry or to make entree into their victims. And it really is a kind of pernicious. And it, in some cases, it's been a very effective tactic because it uses, these updates that come from companies in order to kind of push the malware out to their unsuspecting victims.
And it's really brilliant when you think about it from a tactical perspective.
Well, yeah, because, there again, it's not something that's coming in, by some phishing or other tactic. But it's coming through a channel that you believe to be credible and that it's an update from one of your software providers. And of course, that's also why it's such a danger to these software companies and hurts their credibility with their clients because it reflects poorly on them when they get compromised and then their services are used to pass malware on to their clients.
I think when you look at this threat, Scott, as you and I have followed it for so many years, and we certainly know better than most the dangers that come from cyber attacks. When you start thinking about this from a trending perspective, don't we see more on the horizon?
Oh, my. Yeah, it really isn't. We don't see it slowing down at all. And in fact, we see many of both the state actors and the non-state actors not only, increasing their activity, but really increasing their effectiveness and their capabilities. One of those examples is the Iranians. And we've really seen them upping their game. Maybe a couple of years ago, we were thinking about them in terms of, a second tier threat. But really with the tools that they've been developing, with some of the approaches that they've been using, they're showing that they're up there with really the best of the best.
And when you look at this from a nation state perspective, when you start thinking about the dangers that multinational corporations face, so what can they do about a nation-state attack?
Well, obviously, it's in in the cyber realm there, it's going to manifest similarly to what we're seeing the criminal attacks, the non-state nation-state attacks. The problem is, though, quite frankly, that the sophistication, depending on the actor, can be much greater. So, if you are a company that's being targeted by one of the, very top shelf, Chinese or Russian actors, it's just more difficult to kind of protect against them because they're going to use an array of tools, perhaps even some zero days, and they're going to just use, sophisticated methods that you're really not ready for and tools you're not ready for. But also, kind of in addition to that, one of the things that we're concerned about is having or seeing some of these tools provided by the state sponsors down to their proxies. And actually, just over the last weekend, we saw the Israelis conduct an airstrike, actually, on a Palestinian Hamas, basically cyber warfare center that had been conducting some cyber attacks against Israel. So we're kind of seeing kind of a confluence there of the physical war with the cyber war on the battlefield in Gaza. And, a lot of those capabilities are due to actors like the Iranians who are arming their proxies, such as Hamas and Hezbollah and others, with those capabilities.
I know you and I were tweeting about this, talking about the IDF hit of the Hamas facility that was reportedly associated with cyber. And I think that is one of the impacts of such behavior. I mean, off the top of my head, I can't think of another kinetic response that by any other nation on a location as a result of cyber. Can you?
I mean, I think that we've definitely seen the coalition attack some of the other non-state actors like the Islamic State and some of their kind of propaganda and cyber nodes. But other from, you know, than those kind of, you know, those war zone type activities, this really is kind of an anomalous attack, and is probably the first of many we're going to see.
Yeah, and to your point, when you start looking at this from a nation state perspective, when you think about what the Iranians could do if they wanted to unleash an actor such as Hezbollah that certainly has a cyber capability themselves.
You know, quite frankly, we've seen, Hezbollah very active. We've seen Hamas very active in their activities, not only against the Israelis, but, other opponents in the region. So, this idea that we don't just have to worry about the state actors, but these, kind of non-state proxies is also concerning. I guess part of it, too, is that, like terrorism, if we think about how the state actors were able to, use these terrorist proxies to conduct attacks with, a little bit of plausible deniability, the same thing can be said in the cyber realm, in that, using a proxy as a cutout, does give you some plausible deniability. And, it gives you a little bit more ability to act than if you would do it directly.
And it's very, very difficult. It can be very dark in trying to identify where some of these actors are playing and in the space they're operating in and so forth. But I know that there's not a day that goes by here from discussions with our clients. The insider threat is something that I know you have written a lot about as it pertains to that for ThreatLens.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Especially the sophisticated actors, again, they see cyber as just one tool in the espionage toolbox, and they're going to use whatever tools they need to get the information or to create the impact that they want with their cyber operations. You know, if they can do that remotely from across national borders, that's great. But if they can't, I mean, we've seen them repeated times using other means to get what they, couldn't get through cyber means. And whether that means trying to recruit a human source inside a company, whether that means actually conducting a black bag job on a corporate office or breaking into an executive's home or a hotel room in order to either bug it or to, try to access or even clone their hard drives. These are all the activities that, these sophisticated actors will conduct, and really it goes hand in glove with their cyber activities.
Scott, it's just not nation state targeting of, for example, multinational corporations, but we do have third-party vendors, hosting sites that are being hacked, and then threats of extortion or threats of having that data set distributed onto the internet. So, for example, what do companies do about that if they think that they've contracted with a provider to host their data and that gets hacked?
Yeah, that's really frustrating, for these companies. And, there really are an array of criminal actors that are involved in not only kind of ransomware type attacks, but also where they'll go in, and we saw that example in Germany recently, where they hacked into a web hosting company, downloaded, all kinds of data, and then basically tried to blackmail the company and said, listen, if you guys don't pay us, and it was actually a pretty small amount of money. It was kind of suspicious there. But they said, if you don't pay us $5,000, we're going to start releasing this data to embarrass you. It was extortion, not really traditional ransomware, but it really does kind of highlight not only the vulnerability of hosting companies to attacks, but also those third companies that are trusting hosting companies, with their data. Some people tend to think that the cloud is this mythical place where once your data is up there, nothing can happen to it. But I think it's important to always remember that what the cloud really is somebody else's computer. Those computers are also susceptible to being hacked and attacked, and your data, if it resides on somebody else's computer, can also be compromised. So, hopefully, if you're a company, you've done good due diligence, and you've determined that the safeguards and the security of the hosting provider are, industry standard and sufficient, But unfortunately, if they're not, like in this German case, a great deal of your information can be leaked then when that company gets hacked.
Well, I also know that something else companies could do would be certainly check references, meaning that ask for referrals, ask for some good recommendations, and talk to other people. I just know on a practical level, I would question whether or not that is actually being done.
And well, that's part of the due diligence. I mean, that should be part of your due diligence process.
Part of your procurement process,
references. Really. Yes. Another thing that you can do is really be careful of your data and what data you are sending up, either onto an internal intranet or to a hosting site. And, making sure that you are really carefully protecting what your most sensitive company data is. I believe one of the real secrets of cybersecurity is identifying what's really important and then protecting that carefully and more carefully than everything else. And so if you take those additional steps to, identify and then segregate and limit access to the really sensitive data, that can really help you protect your company against the real fallout of these kind of hacks. As we know, Fred, there's only two kinds of companies, and those that have been hacked and it's known about, and those that have been hacked and they're not admitting it. But a hack doesn't have to be devastating if you have the proper measures in place to really protect your most sensitive data.
Without a doubt. Okay, Scott, that was very interesting. Hopefully we'll be talking about this soon in the future. Thank you. This is Fred Burton from Stratfor.
And this is Scott Stewart from Stratfor. Have a great day.
If you're interested in learning about how Stratfor can help you with analytic tools to visualize and anticipate those areas in the world where your interests and operations are at greatest risk, be sure to visit stratfor.com to learn more about individual, team, and enterprise access at worldview.stratfor.com/subscribe. And if you have a question about this podcast or even an idea for the next one, please drop us an email at podcast@stratfor.com. And as always, if you have a moment, please leave a review on the podcast page on iTunes or wherever it is that you listen. We really appreciate your feedback. For more geopolitical intelligence, links, and fun facts about what goes into forecasting world events, be sure to follow us on Twitter @Stratfor. Thanks for listening.